We've been hearing these reports about gunfire and explosions near the crash site. You were there earlier, and I understand you heard mortar fire yourself?
Yeah, Christy, we did. It was mortar fire, some form of artillery fire, indirect fire, something like that. It was in the near distance, certainly very audible from where we were directly at the crash site itself. And just another reminder that this accident, this terrible tragedy, has taken place within a war zone, within an ongoing conflict area, and it is yet another complication in trying to get the people and the resources that are so desperately needed to that area to recover bodies and find out precisely what happened.
Падла Порошенко, снимаешь ты, падла, чтоб ты сдох.
Уйма, самый настоящий. Не падай, не
падай. Ну, только уже сутки, двое, сколько?
Сюда надо, Порошенко.
Сразу это три залпа было одинаково.
Да, они вот один, второй и третий.
Минометный был огонь, он слышно был этот свист.
А потом, когда уже встали после третьего, видим здесь дым. А после дым как прошел, раз видим люди, ну видно, что лежат люди. Сюда побежали с рынка, мужики наши пошли сюда, смотрели.
Artillery has reportedly been used in the rebel-held city of Lugansk. The Ukrainian government claims that at least five Ukrainian soldiers were killed there in the last 5 days, more than 20 wounded, and on Friday, at least 16 Ukrainian civilians were killed in that city. Of course, a reminder that this plane went down in what is an active, hot, and dangerous war zone. Mm-hmm.
Складское помещение. Горел магазин, склады.
Пострадавшие есть?
Пострадавших нет. Потому как это было ночью, здесь все разошлись по домам. Приехали утром, ребята все затушили. Да, уехали. Ну и потом где-то какой-то был опять начало сгорания.
The delegation from Malaysia arrived in Kiev this morning, from where they're attempting to negotiate access to the site. They'll be joined by eight British air accident investigators later today.
Any action that prevents us from learning the truth about what happened to MH17 cannot be tolerated. Failure to stop such interference would be a betrayal of the lives that we lost. Malaysia calls for all parties to protect the integrity of the crash site and to allow the investigation to proceed.
This area is certainly more controlled than it was, so you wouldn't say it's exactly closed off for a proper investigation. The separatists are keeping people back while the recovery operation gets underway for bodies. Now, this is being carried out by the emergency services from Ukraine. They've got a huge amount of work to do. The hope is, of course, that there will be a ceasefire here so that they can get proper international investigators inside.
Мы хотим, чтобы они как можно скорее оказались бы на месте происшествия. Однако нам было заявлено, что эти группы, да, это группа из 81 человека, она будет сегодня в Киеве совещаться о чем-то. И только завтра, возможно, завтра прибудет к месту событий.
If they not allow us to go to the site, I think this is inhumane. For we are looking at on the humanitarian ground. That's why we are calling the United Nations to assist the ceasefire and also to ensure we are asking the Ukraine authority to ensure us the safe corridor to the site. And this is must be done immediately.
Четыре эксперта с украинской стороны уже прибыли. Они были вчера на месте происшествия, будут и сегодня. Они сейчас в пути туда, на место происшествия, вместе с 14 представителями ОБСЕ.
Well, we're right now, this is our second day here. We were here yesterday for about 75 minutes. Today we're getting more access. We're seeing parts of the debris field that we have not seen before. Right now, as I speak to you, we're looking at a very, very badly damaged piece of earth. The new development today was that they are what they described as experts, so-called experts here. They brought body bags with them, and they're moving the bodies at least to the side of the road.
We have then this morning come back here. You have been waiting for us. You have seen us coming. We have now had the possibility to see a bit more of this rather large scene.
Ukraine authority workers came in, and local miners came in with their helmets and outfits being very identifiable. And they then started rounding up the bodies in their trucks here, and they're loading the body bags on the trucks, and they're transporting them out. So, you know, it's a difficult thing to watch, but it's really important that it's happening. And even though it's being done crudely and they're not being put in, refrigerated or any type of vehicles that are meant for this, they are being taken out of the ground, they are being put onto the trucks, and they are being taken away. I don't know where, we're trying to find out.
Colonel Franksona, I'd like to start with you. There's been a stream of evidence coming from Ukrainian intelligence. They've been sharing some of it with me here. You have these intercepted phone calls as the plane was shot down, apparently as this missile system was delivered. You have the video that Poppy was talking about, seeming to show the missile system being sent back over the border into Russia after the plane was shot down. And there are new photographs, which we're going to share with our viewers shortly, that the Ukrainians have put out, showing not one but three Buk missile systems going back over the border into Russia. You're a military intelligence officer. When you look at this stuff, granted we're in the middle of an information war here between these two sides, but when you look at this, do you consider this credible?
Well, I have to tell you, in doing this for a long time, this seems very convenient to me that all of this information comes out just when you need it. And it's all the damning information that you would need. It just bolsters their case. Now, I'm not saying it's suspect, and the Pentagon has even said they have no reason to doubt it, but I just still, the timing of the whole thing bothers me. It's just too easy. I mean, having done this for a long time, it's never this good.